Welcome to the course on game theory in the autumn term 2020 at the University of Mannheim. This is the second video of week 12, and it is the last video of this course on game theory. And now I want to prove the parts D, E, and F of theorem 626. That was about the Shapley value. Part D gave the fourth characterization of it. It said that the Shapley value of a cooperative game with coalition valuation V is equal to the average of the permutation vectors of this game. So I want to prove this now. Xi upper D is now the map from the set of coalition valuations to the vector space R up to M, which associates to any coalition valuation the average of the permutation vectors of this coalition valuation. So the concrete formula is this 1 over m factorial times the sum over all permutation vectors of the coalition valuation. So, and I will check now that this map satisfies the axioms A1 to A4, even A4 prime. And then by part A, this implies that this map coincides with the Shapley map, Xi Shapley. So that then finishes this fourth characterization of the Shapley map. So Xi upper index D satisfies linearity. That's clear by the formula which defines it. We have the average of the Shapley values of these primitive vectors. And in each entry, each primitive vector is a difference of two of the values of two sets. So the average is also a linear combination of values of sets under the coalition valuation. And that implies that this gives a linear map. So I want to prove also that it satisfies the axiom of 3 of symmetry. So now let sigma in the permutation sigma in SM be an automorphism of a given coalition valuation V, and let pi in SM be any permutation. So I have to show now that the entry of the any permutation vector x upper pi at the index sigma is. I want to show first this formula here. I want to show it. I don't have to, but I want to show that the permutation vector x pi at the entry at the index sigma of I is equal to the permutation vector of the permutation sigma up to minus 1 pi at the index I. I want to show it, and then I will use it. So the first one, by definition, is this difference of the values of the coalitions pi of 1 to pi up to minus 1 of sigma of i. And the second one is then the value of the coalition valuation of the coalition pi of 1 to pi of minus 1 of sigma of I minus 1. So, and now by the symmetry, we can in both cases compose pi on the left hand side with sigma up to minus 1. By the symmetry, we know that this does not change the two values of the two coalitions under the coalition valuation. So this gives them the middle equality, which you see here. But now the new difference of two values is precisely the entry at the index I of the permutation vector for the permutation sigma up to minus 1 pi. So here we have always the sigma up to minus 1 pi at all these entries. And the argument which gives us the index here is, again, sigma up to minus 1 of pi inverse here. Sigma up to minus 1 of pi inverse here. Therefore, we have the index I here downstairs. So this gives us some relation which follows from the symmetry sigma, a relation between different permutation vectors. And now we can use this to prove the axiom A3 of symmetry on the next slide here. So now this the vector Xi upper D which is the average of the permutation vectors at the index sigma of I, has now by definition the entry which is given here. The average of the permutation vectors at the index sigma of I. By the formula which we just have proven, such a single entry is equal to this entry here, so the sum is also equal to the sum. And yeah, this other entry is just psi I upper d of v, because here it doesn't matter whether we sum over all pi or over all products sigma up to minus 1 pi. So if pi runs through Sm, also sigma up to minus 1 pi runs through Sm. Therefore, this sum is again the average over all permutation vectors at the index I. So, and this is psi I d of v. So, this together shows us that we have here the symmetry. Axiom A3 of symmetry is satisfied. Now the axiom A2. We have to show that this vector that vanishes at the entries of the dummy players. So given this again a collision valuation V and given this a dummy player I of V, we have to see that psi di of V is equal to zero. But if you look at the definition of the permutation vectors, then the entry at a dummy player of any permutation vector is equal to zero, because it's the difference of the values of two collisions, and these collisions differ precisely by the player I. So, but because the player I is a dummy player, then this difference must be zero. So any permutation vector has at the index of a dummy player I the entry zero. Then also the average of them has the entry zero. Therefore, this vector psi upper d of v satisfies also the axiom A2 of the dummy player. And finally, we have to see that psi upper d satisfies the axiom A1 of effectivity, or the collective rationality. We have to see that the sum of all these entries of this vector is equal to v of a. So the sum of all these entries is the sum over all players I of the averages of the entries. So we can reorder this sum here. We can first sum over the permutations and then sum over the players I. But then the second sum here is just V of A, because the permutation vectors themselves satisfy this axiom of effectivity. We had seen that they are imputations, so the sum of the entries is always equal to V of A. So then we have 1 over m factorial times the sum of all permutations of V of A. So it is 1 over m factorial times V of A, which is equal to V of A. So therefore, the sum of the entries of our vector psi upper d is equal to the value of the total collision. So this gives us also the axiom A1. Now by part A, we know that there's a unique map which satisfies all four axioms, the Shapley map, and therefore the map psi upper d is equal to the Shapley map. So this finishes the proof of part D. So now about part E. Part E said that the Shapley value of a game is an imputation if the game is superadditive. So suppose now that the game is superadditive. We want to see that it is the Shapley value is an imputation. So there were two axioms, the axiom of individual rationality and the axiom of collective rationality. But A1 is precisely the axiom of collective rationality, so that holds anyway. So the only thing to be shown is that the axiom of individual rationality holds. And this is then precisely this, what we have to show. For any player I, the entry of the Shapley value at the player I is bigger or equal to the value of the one-player collision, which consists of player I. So now we go back to some calculation which we had done in the proof of theorem 6.18, when we first consider these permutation vectors. The entry of the permutation vector x pi for some index pi of j is by definition the difference which you see here. And we had seen in the proof of theorem 618 that this is bigger or equal to this, the value of the one-player collision, pi of j. And the reason was just the superadditivity of the game. So especially then we get this inequality. So any entry of the of some permutation vector is bigger or equal to the value of the one-player collision, which such that the player is the index of this entry. So now we look at the average of the permutation vectors. We use the formula in part D. So we know that the Shapley, the entry at the index I of the Shapley value is equal to the entry of the index I of the vector defined in part D, which is the average of the permutation vectors. So here we get the average of the ith entries of the permutation vectors. And each ith entry of a permutation vector is bigger to v of I, so we get then this sum here. Again, we have here sum over m factorial elements and the factor 1 over m factorial, and that cancels out, so we get v of I. That means that the ith entry of the Shapley value is bigger or equal to the value of the one-player collision, which consists of player I. So this gives us also the axiom of individual rationality, and this shows that the Shapley value is an imputation in the case of a superadditive game. And the last part F, I had already explained it in the video before the last video, when I discussed the theorem. So I repeat it. So suppose the game is convex, then the Shapley value is even in the core of the game. And this is easy because, again, by part D, the Shapley value is the average of the permutation vectors. And by theorem 618a, each permutation vector is contained in the core, and the core is convex, and more precisely, but we don't need it, the core is even the convex hull of the set of permutation vectors. So now the average of the permutation vectors is certainly a convex combination of permutation vectors, so it is in their convex hull, and so it is in the core of the game. So this shows that the Shapley value is in the core of the game if the game is convex. And I do not even need any unproved part. You remember that theorem 618a was not proved completely. But I need only the parts which I proved. I proved that the permutation vectors are in the core, and we knew from lemma 6.7 already that the core is convex, and that's sufficient here. So this finished the proof of theorem 618. This was finally a quite long theorem and an interesting proof, and this is really important object, this Shapley value, with lots of applications. But in this course, I will now restrict to two small applications or to two small examples. I return for a moment to the example 613, the water supply system for 4 communities. And here I want now to calculate the Shapley value for this cooperative game. But surprisingly, first I make some symmetry consideration. I consider the set of all the permutations of the players 1 to 4, which are automorphisms of this cooperative game. So you do not even have to remember the table of the values of the collision values precisely, but you remember that the communities 1 and 2 were close, and therefore the Shapley value of this collision was smaller than that of an average pair, and the same for the two communities 3 and 4. So the two villages, the two communities 1, 2 had the value 4, and the two communities 3, 4 had also the value 4. And the others had value 5, and all coalitions of 3 communities had value 6, and the total coalition had value 7, and the conditions of only one village had value 3. So, and this shows us clearly that, any permutation is a symmetry of this game if it maps the set of the communities 1 and 2 to itself, and also the set of the communities 3, 4 to itself, or if it exchanges these two sets. So if the set 1, 2 goes to the set 3, 4, and the set 3, 4 goes to the set 1, 2. So in altogether, we find that we have here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 automorphisms. So a quite large group of automorphisms. The game is quite symmetric. And the conclusion and implication is here that the orbit of the commute of the element 1 under this subgroup, under this symmetry group of the game, consists of all 4 communities. So I have sufficiently many permutations in the subgroup to map the community 1 to any possible community. Here the transposition 1, 2 maps 1 to 2, and this permutation maps 1 to 3, and this permutation maps 1 to 4. So therefore, the situation is sufficiently symmetric, and by the axiom of symmetry, the entries for the communities 1, 2, 3, 4 in the Shapley value are all equal. And by the axiom A1 of effectivity, the sum of the entries must be the collision value of the total collision 7. This implies immediately that any entry of the Shapley value is equal to 7 divided by 4. They are all equal and their sum must be equal to 7, so they are all equal to 7 divided by 4. So this is something which I had claimed in section 6.2. Of course, we didn't know the definition at that time, but now we see why it's true. The second example is something rather concrete. Suppose we have some construction site and a company with M workers, construction workers. One of them is the foreman. He is important and he takes responsibility, and the others not so. So, and the situation is quite extreme. So there are several possibilities that maybe not all of them will be there on one working day, and then the work depends on the subset, on the coalition of the workers who are there. If the subset of workers who are there at one day contains the foreman and at least one other worker, then the result of the work has a value 1. If the foreman is missing, it still has value 1 if all other workers work together. But in all the other cases, the work of that day has value 0. That means if the foreman is missing and at least one other worker is missing, the rest of the workers will get done nothing. And if the foreman is there, but if he is alone without a hand to help him, he also will get done nothing. So this is a rather extreme situation. So the foreman seems to be very important, and the Shapley value will tell us that he is really surprisingly important. So for any coalition with one element, the value of the work is 0, even if it's the foreman. And for the total coalition, the value is 1. So therefore, this cooperative game is a 0-1 reduced game, and especially it is an essential game. So in exercise 3 of sheet 11, you are asked to show that this game is super additive, not convex, and that its core is empty. So this is exercise 3 of sheet 11, and I will not discuss this exercise here. It will be discussed in 1 week later. What I want to do now is to calculate the Shapley value for this cooperative game. The calculation is done here. So I take the definition in part C of the last theorem, so this weighted sum of differences of values of coalitions. So first I look at the entry for the foreman M of the Shapley value. So by definition, this is this weighted sum. I sum over all coalitions B And I can restrict to those which contain the foreman, because in the other cases the difference of the values is equal to zero. So I restrict to all the coalitions B which contain the foreman M. And I take the difference V of B minus V of M minus B, and I multiply this by this fixed rational coefficient, this weight. And now I use that I know in all cases what this difference is, the difference here of V of B minus V of B minus M. If B is a total set, then both entries are 1. The work done by all workers has value 1, and the work done by all workers except the foreman has also value 1, so the difference is 0. If the set has only one member, and this member is the foreman, and he gets done nothing, and the empty set also gets done nothing, so then we have 0 minus 0, which is 0. In all other cases, in all other sets B, which contain the foreman, and which have so at least 2 and at most m minus 1 members, the difference is 1. Because then this coalition B gets some good work done with value 1, and the coalition without the foreman is a proper subset of all the other workers, and it gets done nothing in this working day. So for all the other coalitions B which contain the foreman and which have between 2 and m minus 1 workers, members, the difference of these two values is equal to 1. So it's sufficient now to add over these sets. And here now I split them in depending on the number of their elements. So small b is now here by definition the number of elements of such a set, big B. And it's between 2 and m minus 1. And now I have to calculate how many sets big B with small b elements we have. So we consider only sets of workers which contain the foreman and which have small b many elements for b between 2 and m minus 1. So we can take out the foreman in all cases. Then we have a subset with b minus 1 elements of the set of all workers except the foreman, which has m minus 1 elements. And it's well known from probability theory that the number of these subsets is m minus 1 over b minus 1. And here downstairs I have written the formula for this coefficient. And we see immediately that m minus 1 factorial almost cancels with m factorial, and b minus 1 factorial cancels with b minus 1 factorial, and m minus 1, m minus b factorial cancels with m minus b factorial. So we have m minus 1 factorial divided by m factorial, which is 1 over m. So we get here the sum from b equal 2 to m minus 1 of 1 over m, and this is finally m minus 2 over m. So we see that the entry in the Shapley value of the foreman is very large. It is m minus 2 divided by m. So if there are many workers, it's already close to 1. That means that almost all the value of the work is due to the foreman. So, and what is the value? What are the values of the other workers? They must be very small, because the sum of all the values must be equal to 1 by this axiom of effectivity, axiom A1 for the Shapley value. And the axiom of symmetry tells us that the entries in the Shapley value of the other workers are all equal, so they must share this rest 2 divided by m with one another, and we have m minus 1 such workers, so each worker then has the value 2 divided by m minus 1 times m. So this is the entry in the Shapley value for all the workers 1 to m minus 1, so it's really small. So this is even more extreme than one might expect in this example. The Shapley value tells that the contribution of the foreman is very, very important, and the contributions of the other players is quite small. So this is one useful and one meaningful application of the Shapley value. It tells us the importance here of the contribution of the work of the different workers under the given circumstances. And there are lots of other applications of the Shapley value, especially also in the calculation of the voting power of other kinds of power in parliaments. But I will not go into this in this course. So this finishes the course of game theory. And I thank you very much for your attention.